I'm gonna have to keep this kind of silence. Can everybody hear the music and the guitar?
Yeah.
All the way in the back? Great, okay. Sounds like it's working. I'm a bit deaf, so. I might talk quiet. I might talk loud.
I might talk quiet, but that might help.
All right. Cool.
How's it going, everybody?
Good.
I'm Steve Smyth, and welcome to my masterclass here at Silly Strings. We're going to get started with a little bit of a reintroduction just shortly. So I'm going to reintroduce myself to the community to explain that I've been away for about 13 years. I've been living in England and have recently came back and am back to teaching, playing, and doing what I do, basically back here, back home. So I'll get on with that in just a moment. Be right back with you. Yeah, I'm going to have to turn this thing on and off. I can tell it's going to be a bit ringy as we go. So first thing I'm going to do, I'm just going to kick it off with some of the latest music that I've been doing with my band called One Machine. And it's basically a band that I've had over in the UK for many years now. And we've put out two records, one called The Distortion of Lies and The Overdriven Truth, which was released about 4 years ago, 2014. The second is called The Final Call, and I'm going to play the title track from that album right now. I think everyone can hear me. Everyone can hear everything, so we'll just get on with it. Here we go.
Probably gonna do a mixture of sitting and standing a little bit here, just so I can kind of get my bearings going with this thing.
Yeah.
never the best one to open with, but that's how it is. Yeah, a couple things about that song, just really quick. I just wanted to kind of explain some of the stuff. And then if you guys do this for us, if you can sign up on an email sheet that the folks here have at the back, I can send you guys transcriptions of what we go over today, just so you can see that. Just want to point out a couple things about just certain things that I played in this song. When we wrote this song, the idea was just the lyrical content notwithstanding. I mean, it was basically just there was a lack of melody going on in metal, and I wanted to kind of bring that back a little bit more. With what we were doing with One Machine, because we started off a little bit more kind of the shouty kind of thing with a little bit of melody, and then on this record we got a little bit more melodic with a little bit less of the shouty stuff, and we had a great singer who was able to kind of mix the two together quite well, and it's pretty rare when you can find that, but it's actually pretty cool at the same point. Couple things that we did. Basically, tried to get like a real classical kind of sound and sense happening in there. So when I wrote the intro, that was kind of what was happening with that. So there's the that whole beginning that was happening there. So it's in. I want to call it F sharp, but it's actually technically F because I'm tuned down. I've got a unique kind of tuning that I do. It's E flat, but it's 4:45, so it's not your everyday tuning, I guess. And a lot of people always ask, well, why do you do that, dude? And the only explanation I can actually give is that whenever I tune a guitar without a tuner, just by myself, this is the tuning that I naturally gravitate to. So I was like, you know, I give up. Whatever happened with my ear a long time ago or whatever, I was always told I had perfect pitch by my teacher, many teachers actually. But the thing is that, you know, you always have kind of a natural tone that you tend to gravitate towards. And I always say go with that. So I just finally said, you know what, I'm just going to go with it. And that was what we did from the very start, very first record that we did for One Machine onwards up to present day and beyond. So that's the first thing. It's basically I'm tuned to E445 or E flat to 445, and it's a little bit different tuning. It doesn't sound kind of sounds like E, but not quite E, and then it's like kind of like E flat, but not quite E flat. So it's right in between the actual two there. There's a couple things that we did, and hopefully I can get this to happen here. The middle section, it's a bit of a take on the beginning. So what I was doing is basically outlining chords here. So it's kind of like a and then basically a C sharp. So kind of a 1, 6, 4, and then 5 happening from there. So there's a lot of different transitions that happen with that melody that we played earlier, and then it jumps into that actual sound there. Hopefully I'll get that ring sorted. So yeah, that's one of the things I was doing in there. And then let me see if I can actually get this to
you guys can still hear me.
Yeah.
So this other thing that I was doing was it's just kind of a series of harmonic minor, just kind of running up through the entire scale. I'm a bit more of a legato player, naturally. I don't usually pick everything I play. There are certain things I'll pick, and the reason why I tend to gravitate towards picking certain things and not picking certain things is that I want to accent things a bit more. So with that's why I usually use a pick for. It's more like percussion. That's kind of the I think what the ideal is what it was meant for. And whenever I hear somebody picking like alternate all the way through, it's totally cool. I love it. One person that comes to mind is Yngwie Malmsteen. He's definitely got that really just sly technique of being able to get that very smoothly across. However, I hear every note is like a percussion, so I'm like, whoa, this is crazy. But it's a little bit different. So I tend to go a little bit smoother as I like to hear that a bit more. So with that, it's more like a kind of a diagonal pattern. Let me see if I can come across you guys here. Can you still see that? Okay. So I'm playing six notes and I take it up an octave. So I'm playing E. I'm just going to call these out as if they're natural. So E, F sharp, G, and then we've got A sharp, B, and then C sharp. So we're playing E in the F sharp harmonic minor. But I tend to look at it as basically that Phrygian dominant, so kind of building off of that. So B. And obviously there we're going to run out of room, so we have to bring that up an octave higher from there. So one of my favorite things to do is to kind of roll that type of thing forward, and I'll kind of guide the pick. If you watch my pick hand as well as this, I'll play it a few times. But kind of use certain notes to actually get the accent, plus I'm kind of guiding along with alternate picking just a little bit more like that. So almost forgot the end of that leg there, but yeah, that's last few notes, I'm basically accenting those a bit heavier than the rest of those. So that's kind of the main idea I was doing there. One other thing too, on the subject of kind of moving between harmonic minor and then Phrygian dominant, basically the sound of those, if I was to play, I'll play this on a single string. I find that linear scales are probably the easiest way to see what a scale is and what it's made of, that kind of thing. So. Harmonic minor, right? So it's like a natural minor. It's I'm going to call these out as tone and semitone, or whole step, half step. We'll go whole step, half step first. So whole step, half step, whole step, half, minor third. So that's a tone and a half, and then half step from there. So we've got the harmonic minor happening there, and then I'm going to go from the seventh string here to play this one. This is Phrygian dominant, but in B. So it's a little bit different kind of thing. This is like playing from the fifth note of the harmonic minor scale. So it's half step up, minor third, half step, tone or whole step, half step, and then tone again. That's kind of what I'm doing, but I'm playing six notes out of that instead of all seven. So there's just one note missing. So there's just one note missing, and that's... So that's the one thing that I kind of take out of that. People call those hexatonics, six-tone scales. So basically six instead of seven. Diatonic would be like the natural minor scale, or the Phrygian dominant that we were playing before. So that type of thing happened there. And then the lick that's underneath the main solo or the riff, I should say, is basically a Phrygian dominant based type of thing, but I'm using pretty much the whole scale, just kind of playing off a bit a little different. So it goes up. Mm-hmm. like doing that sometimes just to get a certain sound across that that might not be able to be had any other way. I mean, if I play that in a position, it's going to sound so different. It starts changing a little bit, you know what I mean? So to get that sameness, that's kind of what I've done, is basically ended up playing that on just one string. I just like the sound a bit better, and I can also inflect with the pick a bit more. And you can get things like pedal points and other things like that a little bit easier in there. Yeah, so I just want to share those things with you guys. I have that stuff written out, so I'll be able to send that to you. Just sign up for email with us at the back or at the end as we have that. So I want to take you through a little history, and we'll get this underway, and then we're going to play a little bit more music, kind of go between all that stuff today a bit more. Right, so reintroducing myself, direct you to the screen, and get underway here. I think this is going to work. Is that coming through? It's barely coming through. Yeah, hey, do you have the remote? Mm-hmm. Volume? Yeah, because I forgot I was using the television volume for this.
You're probably reaching from here.
Right, so we've got this here. Yeah. So here we go. Anybody remember this song?
Yeah.
This is about the time that all this was happening for me. So basically, my first band was called Metallic Rage.
Yeah.
And guess who we really liked? Right? So yeah, turn that off. No, I didn't spend most of my days on the playground. basically, first song I ever wrote, we used in this junior high school talent show, right? And we won second place. We were supposed to have first, but then the jazz band came in and did this complete like 15-minute improvisation and took the prize. Also, they hid the drum rug from us. So when we were up on stage, right, the drummer, his kick drum was coming out. He didn't know what to do. First time on stage, so our bass player did the natural thing. Any bass players in here? I don't want to offend any bass players, but
yeah.
The natural thing that a bass player could do, put his foot right in front of the kick drum, held it down, held down the low end, and basically saved our gig from complete collapse, which is only one song, but it felt like, oh my God, you know, this is in front of the whole school. It's crazy. So yeah, we took second place. Damn jazz band. But a couple years later, we formed a band called Panic, not to be confused with the Seattle band, which we later discovered, hey, there's a thrash band from Seattle called Panic. Maybe we shouldn't use that name. So we decided not to. We had an early lineup. We recorded our first demo with Jeff Thorpe from Vicious Rumors. How many know Vicious Rumors?
Bay Area, yeah.
Okay. Right. So Jeff basically was a buddy with our singer at the time, a guy named Hill. And Hill got Jeff to basically produce our first demo. Took us under his wing, kind of got us on some gigs opening for those guys and stuff, and really gave us a good chance, gave us a good fighting chance. Things didn't work out with Hill, unfortunately, but I kept that friendship with Jeff over the years. And that played into a few things later, so I'll explain that in a moment. We had that. We started playing local shows, everything like that. Things didn't work out with Hill. We had to change our name, so lots of changes were going on. Well, we ended up with a really great female singer who's, well, she's retired now, but her name was Brenda, and she was a tremendous, like really loud, 3-4-octave singer who could just belt it out. And for the time, we were like the... I think the only band in the Bay Area that actually had a female singer around the mid to late 80s that were doing like progressive type of almost thrashy heavy metal, which kind of made us stand out a little bit and also kind of made people kind of like go,
I don't know, but you know, we didn't care. We loved what we did, and we just went with it. So that was kind of fun. We changed the name to Ariah, which is a bit of a weird name. It was our bass player, Steve, his idea to have to name the band Ariah. And I'm like, okay, what does it mean? He's like, I don't know, but it sounds cool. I'm like, all right, yeah, let's go with it. So we did that. We play a lot of Bay Area clubs. Like I said, with Vicious Rumors, we got opportunities to open for them, which turned into other opportunities as well. Locally and in the Bay Area as well. We opened up for quite a few people, Testament being one of them, and then later on Quiet Riot as well too, which was still before, I think Rudy Sarzo was in the band at that point. This is like 91, 92, something like that. So it was pretty interesting to, he wasn't in the band, it was Chuck Wright playing bass. That's what it was, yeah. So that was pretty cool just to get to play with those guys and listen to them sing Mental Health, and to open the show in the first place. Kind of exciting. That being Randy Rhodes, one of my heroes. It was his band, his early bands. They were playing some of those songs as well, which is kind of cool. We had a demo that we did, not with Jeff Thorpe, but with ourselves. I was actually producing it at that one, and we got some label interest, but it never happened, so the band broke up, and we just said, okay, that's where everybody's going. We're going our separate ways. From there, myself and Steve, the bass player, we got these instrumental demos together, because we were kind of getting into instrumental music, like all the Shrapnel Records stuff that happened in the 80s. We always had our ear on that. We're like, wow, who's this? Who's that? Who's this incredible bass player from Racer X who can like rip like a lead guitar player, that kind of thing? And so we were pretty into that. And Steve kind of had these different influences that were a bit more progressive minded, and he got me into that pretty early on back in the mid to late 80s when we first met. So it kind of caught me a little bit, and we started writing these instrumental songs on our own, and then we put our stuff together, and we formed this thing called the EssenEss Project, which is basically a phonetic spelling for Steve and Steve, or S and S, and that was our name there for a bit. And we kind of had two versions of the band. We worked with Mike Varney to try and put together something, and we very nearly landed a deal with Shrapnel Records. But again, things didn't kind of work out because we couldn't lock down all the musicians in the band to make it happen. So things happened, but our demos cut Mike's ear, and he ended up putting us in the Hometown Heroes column of Guitar World magazine, which he had a long time ago. Prior to that, he had Guitar Player, then he had Guitar World, and we were very fortunate to be able to get featured in that. So that was a pretty cool thing. I got in October, then Steve got in November. And it helped us out a little bit because we got a little bit of notice and we started hearing from different people. One guy that comes to mind that I heard from very early on was Michael Romeo. He was also from a band called Symphony X, if anyone knows that band. So I have been able to kind of count that back, and he remembers, oh yeah, that's right. It was a funny conversation about video games or something like that, because he was busy playing video games at the time that we had one of our phone conversations. So I'll never forget that, because it was a certain video game. I'm like, wow, you actually still play that? it was weird. That really kind of opened up a few doors. We worked with one of the Shrapnel Session drummers, the guy that did like most of the records, a guy named Atma Anyer. He's done a lot of stuff in the Bay Area and beyond. And so Atma did our four-song demo with us, which was great, which we sold as an EP. We began playing local and Bay Area shows, and it was just kind of weird because no one had really heard what we were doing before, and it kind of caught some people funny, and other people were like, yeah, this is cool. It's kind of like Satriani, but not really. It's kind of like Satriani meets Yes. And it was like, okay, yeah, I'll take that. That works, so we got a different drummer, a guy named Ron Verdeen, who played with a band called Spiral Arms, Bay Area band, former band of an ex bandmate of mine, Craig with Cicero from Forbidden, I'll talk about him a little bit later. We took a hiatus as I got a really cool gig that came up around about 1995. More about that in a second, but basically 2003 kind of rolled around. I was pretty busy. I was in a handful of bands. I was playing with Testament, We also had the band Dragonlord happening, but it wasn't as busy. We basically had already done a record, we'd done some touring. And then another band came along called Nevermore, and that was basically kind of a different thing as well too. So I had all these things going on. And then Steve was like, hey, maybe we should try and put all these songs together that we had for an album that we're gonna release back then, but update them a little bit and see what happens. And so we ended up doing that. We released that in 2007. It's a self-released and self-titled. I've got a few of those today if anyone's interested in checking it out. I'm gonna attempt to play at least one or two of those songs today as well too. So basically that kind of happened, and we did a little touring in support of that in 2008. And things just got a little busy. I guess I spelled something wrong there, but started writing for a new album, and then we started recording in 2012, but between me and Steve, we're pretty busy with schedules, so stay tuned. One of these days we'll get it done, maybe 2020, I don't know. We'll have to see where it goes. But yeah, that happened. Like I said, I got a call about a really cool gig. So this happened. Big time, right? So it's basically Vicious Rumors, and a mutual friend of myself and Jeff gave me a call and said, hey, the lead guitar player just quit the band. And I'm like, really? When did this happen? He's like, it just happened last night. And I'm like, wow, okay, cool. He's like, you should go down and go go talk to Jeff and see if you can jam with him and check it out. So I'm like, yeah, sure. So I went down there after talking to Jeff. He's like, yeah, come on down, let's check it out. You know? And he's all, how many songs do you know? And I said, well, being a fan and, you know, basically opening for those guys several times, probably about 18 to 20 songs. He's like, no way. I'm like, yeah. So went in there and I shocked him because I actually knew 18 to 20 of their songs reasonably well. I'm not going to say I knew them perfect note for note, like all the way start to end, but he kind of helped out with that a little bit, but or actually a lot. that happened. Some things kind of happened. Unfortunately, their singer got in a very bad car accident and passed away while I was actually jamming with those guys. And very sad time, definitely. They weren't really sure if they were going to continue, if they were going to go on anymore. And I totally understood. I got a call a couple months later saying that they wanted to continue with what I'd be interested in jamming. And we ended up finishing writing the record that they were working on with Carl Albert, their singer. It was called Something Burning. And I put a song on there as well, which was called Free to Go. It's the last song on the record. And it sounded a bit like that band, except kind of like a bit like heavier kind of that kind of thing. So we made it even heavier. And Jeff ended up singing on the record. We did that one in 1996. Cyberchrist was our next record together in 1998. Lots of touring, lots of chances to open up for international acts. Rainbow is one that comes to mind. Funny story, Jeff trying to go backstage to meet Richie Blackmore. Richie Blackmore has security and everything like that. He never likes to meet anybody. He just hides in the back until he's done playing and leaves. So Jeff ended up giving him a big bear hug and then getting booed outside. So we saw this guy come flying out. We're like, whoa, what happened, man? Because he's like, oh my God. He's all, I tried to give Richie a hug, but security threw me out. So it was crazy. Yeah, it was crazy, man. Definitely. But first tour with those guys, with Vicious Rumors, was opening for Accept in Europe on their farewell tour back in 1996. And it was 7 weeks across Europe on a bus. I say a bus, and everyone probably thinks like this big, huge bus. Well, this was a converted school bus that they threw bunks in. And it was the tiniest thing ever, but it was so cool. Because it was just, there's a little lounge in the back, and bunks right in the middle, and then you had the front seats, and that was it. And we did that for 7 weeks, and just had a blast going across Europe on that tour. In 1999, I got a little call for another gig that kind of came around, and it was an offer I couldn't refuse. But really quickly, I'm going to take you guys back to something. Still working? Okay. standby for this thing. I think this thing is pretty cool. Yeah. So this is that that solo riff from the final call. I've got it written out there for you in notation and also in tablature for how many here read notes? Okay, handful, yeah. And tablature. Right. So we've got both there kind of figured out. And it's that single note kind of thing that happens with that, and that's the Phrygian dominant riff that I was playing earlier on the seventh string, and that's in B right there. So we've got that. With both endings that happen at the end there. Cool. Now, I don't have a delay for this thing, but let's see if I can play this really quickly. That's probably the hardest part, but this is a little tapping thing that I composed for the song called "The Afterlife," and this is from the EssenEss Project. It's all instrumental stuff, so we're always trying to get like a theme or an idea, something like that, to have to happen with that. And the idea with this. Favorite scales to play, it's basically a Lydian dominant, which is built on melodic minor. It sounds a lot like a major towards the end, but it's minor at the front of it. So with that, I kind of came up with this thing because I wanted to get like a really cool kind of sound that was in A. But playing those notes from that particular scale to get a sound in there and to have kind of a melody. Actually playing within the tap. Let's see if I can play that again and see if we can spot that. Starts here. Does that make sense? Yeah, so that's the front of the song. I'm gonna see if I can actually play this thing. There was the one that I just got from this. Thank you. see how I go with this. It's... One moment. This song is actually in 440. One thing I really like to do is I like to use a lot of different tunings. I always felt like, I don't know, music doesn't necessarily need to be confined to just one certain thing. So. Also playing with other people, especially too, I've always noticed that everybody has their own preferred tuning as well. For instance, playing with Vicious Ermers, we played in E flat, but we also played in C sharp, and then a couple songs I wrote were actually in drop B, so basically a C sharp standard with the low E tuned to a B, so tuned like the D string. So we're trying to get more of a baritone type of sound with that. When we played with Testament, it was largely D, C sharp, and E flat as well. So kind of all over this one. That's the big beginning of the song. It's going to carry off into this next thing. Just a little bit of it, because it won't match. So basically on that same theme of the scale, we went with that for the entire front of the song as well too. So the chords, basically an A sus there, seven sus, G add, like Time Changes. It's basically a bar of 13, a bar of 11, a bar of 9, and then a bar of 8, which is weird. So let me try and walk you through that as we go back here. That sound, it's kind of a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3. It keeps going like that. So we're in an 8 feeling. So basically you got an 8th note that it's treated like a quarter note as you do that. And it's, I mean, more or less, we had to look back on that, and our, the drummer, Appa, we got him back to come and do the record with us. And he was more the guy that kind of guided us through that a little bit. We're like, oh, okay, yeah, cool. Good. So we'll double everything in our head, and then we'll be able to play that. I was like, all right, cool. But what if we just go, right? But, you know, you have to kind of find that point of where that actually is. So it took a little bit of counting process to find that. And it was, 13, 11, 9, and then bar of 8 from there. And we just kept everything more or less steady out from there. But it moved forward. Pretty progressively. I mean, it's this was written originally back in 1995, right before I got this this Vicious Rumors gig, and that was the thing that kind of changed a little bit with that song. Was the front of the song wasn't there, so we just had the front of it, but we didn't play it the same way. We changed the themes and everything else like that for the record to kind of have it branch out a little bit more. And Abba was pretty key with that. So often, I mean, with the songwriting, I always find that collaborating is one of the best things. I mean, you know, you can always have a strong idea or even a full song, but sometimes when you get other people's input, there's something really cool that happens. There's a lot of magic there that really comes to light. So it's one of the fun things I like to do with music is just being able to play with other people and create music together like that. So. Not to digress too much, but I want to get on with a few other songs, which hopefully the balance on this thing will be all right, or I'll have to adjust it up, because I know somebody's running hot. But that's the front of the song that I wanted to share with you guys, and I think... right, I put the verse riff in there. So that's in 10, you can see this, it's in 10, and then it's in 12, and kind of back and forth through that. That's this riff here. It goes on into this really crazy kind of thing. I think for time purposes, I'm going to have to kind of move ahead a little bit. But yeah, you can find that. There's a EMG video from EMG TV back a few years back that I did. I played a solo performance of that song. So yeah, definitely go and visit that to check it out if you want to hear more of that. Back to the big time. What I got was a call to join Testament, or not to join them, but to join them on a tour. And that tour basically started out as a 3-week tour of Europe and then over to Japan for a week. And those 3 weeks kind of turned into another phone call, hey, want to do this tour? Want to do this one? And then just kind of snowballed into, okay, he's in, he's going to basically play with us. And that's that. And I was like, wow, okay, so this is cool. The hows and the whats, basically my guitar tech from Vicious Rumors was actually out with Eric Peterson on tour. Things kind of happened with one of the other guitar players, and we later found out he had a really bad illness, which later was successfully dissolved, which is great, great news. But and he was a friend too, so this is kind of a hard thing. But I went in filling in for him, and then ended up getting the gig. And there was always little loggerheads after that, and it's like, okay, it smoothed over eventually. But yeah, that was kind of a tough one. But we had a lot of fun. We did a lot of touring around the world with those guys, and I got to play a lot of their very classic songs, as well as their at the time their new record, which kind of changed direction for them a little bit. It was called The Gathering. Came out in 1999. A lot of fun to play that one. Yeah, I love that record, definitely. Very hard to play some of that stuff too. It's very very involved, but just fast, really really fast. They had Dave Lombardo playing drums on that record, and everybody knows who Dave Lombardo is, right? Slayer drummer, really fast, crazy, and just intense stuff to play. So they were writing, or at least Eric was writing, a lot of riffs and stuff. And I later found out, I mean, when they got the band back together with Alex and Greg, came back in, I think it was Paul Bostaff was first drumming with them way back then. Formation of Damnation, and then the next record after that, and the next one after that. I started hearing some of these riffs that we had worked on with Eric. They kind of creeped their way into full songs. I was like, wow, that's awesome to finally hear, because I never thought that they were going to write another record ever, because they couldn't figure out where they wanted to go. So that was kind of cool to hear. Help program drums and like play second guitar parts and stuff, which I was happy to hear Alex kept some of that. So it was cool. It was like, yeah, awesome. We never did a record together, but no big deal. We had a side project with Eric Peterson, which is called Dragonlord. I'm going to play one of those songs shortly, but I'm going to back up to Vicious Rumors really quick and play a song from them. Dragonlord kind of happened from 1999 to 2005. It started in Eric Peterson's garage and blossomed from there into two albums, lots of touring, and just a different path entirely. It's symphonic black metal was what it was called by the first label. So it stuck, and we're like, yeah, okay, that sounds cool. we'll go with it. It was a bit more like thrash metal meets black metal, but with keyboards. So has anyone heard Dragonlord? Right? Okay, so you know what I mean. It's cool. It's heavy. It's a little bit different. Eric actually took on the vocal roles and kind of did a mixture of singing and the more like black metal kind of voice. It made it interesting. It was cool. I've never played that music before. Always, you know, kind of listened to it. Something that I was a fan of certain bands, but never thought I'd ever have the opportunity or chance to play that kind of stuff. So it was kind of cool. I was like, yeah, okay, this is awesome. Let's try this. Co-wrote a few things on the first one, and then the second one I got a song or two in there and some bits. And it was a lot of fun. I'm gonna take you back to Vicious Rumors, and I'm gonna have to play along with the CD here. On this one. I'm gonna play a song called Cyberchrist. And this was the title track of record of the same name. Let's see if I can get this. So bear with me really quickly. I'm just going to walk you through this as a tune. The song is basically in C sharp tuning. And there it is. C sharp with a drop D, so it's a drop B sound as we go through that. So I'm just going to quickly tune to. And kind of a little thing about that one, like I said before, I like to use a lot of linear type of stuff, and this one was purely written as a linear idea. Anyone ever heard the song, Led Zeppelin song, Friends, before? That's kind of what I based this on, which is weird, but I'll show you what I mean. So it's that song that goes, stuff right there, especially that last bit, always kind of stuck with me. I'm like, wow, that's pretty cool. I wish I could write a riff like that. And it kind of came to me. I was like, yeah, you know what? Actually, this could maybe be the chance. And so what I did was I basically took that inspiration and kind of came up with this. It was more like basically in drop B as it is. So we're kind of near the tuning. That song is in C, I think, and it's an open C tuning on an acoustic guitar. So this was basically drop B. That's basically how it kind of started. I'm like, I want to create a riff like that. Didn't know really how or what I was going to do with it, but then it just kind of came about, and I developed it into something like that. Gets a little bit heavier as we go. I'm going to play the whole song for you right now. And you can hear the 1990s calling. Thank you. It started kind of from that particular sound, and hey, that's next week. That's not this week. From that friend song, right? And then that riff kind of was like, you know, I love that riff. I want to be able to like write a song like that, and that's just what started and snowballed into that idea. And then Brian, the singer of Vicious Rumors, had this idea that he floated over the top of that and took off from there. We just kept going until we had the entire thing. Obviously, some of those riffs aren't related to that Led Zeppelin Friends sound, but definitely started from that, and then moved into that sound overall. So there's that one, and I want to see. So we had that. Dragonlord actually was the one I wanted to take you to next. So I will get to that. It's kind of a cool thing that happened on one of the earlier songs. Flashing forward. So as I was saying, during that one period of time, like 2000 to 2005, roughly, I was in probably about four or five different bands, all going at once. So there was a lot of work kind of happened. 2002, I got a call to come in and see if I could jam with the guys in Nevermore, who were friends, and we basically kind of got together. What I didn't realize, I brought up a six-string guitar, right? And at the time, I didn't really realize that what they were playing on was what Jeff was playing on. Jeff Loomis was playing on was a 7-string guitar. And he's all, "You don't have a 7?" I'm like, "No, man, I brought my 6. Because I was remembering all their other stuff and haven't really checked out the latest record yet. And so he's like, "Oh, wow, okay, so we got to get you a 7. So we went and found a really cheap one and started jamming on the songs from the Dead Heart in the Dead World record. And I ended up, it was supposed to be a full tour, got reduced to one festival show, which was Bang Your Head Festival in 2002. Real blast, but unfortunately I don't remember the entire thing because I lost my passport in Seattle the day before we were supposed to leave, right? So I had to stay behind, get a quick processed passport, and then get over there. Completely jet lagged. Warl and Jim meet me at the airport, Frankfurt Airport, and here, have a buddy. And buddy is a beer. And I'm like, "Oh, all right, cool. It'll help you stay awake." And I'm like, "I don't know if it's gonna help me stay awake, but it might calm my nerves just a little bit." And it kind of turned into that like the entire day. So by the time we hit the stage, which was late afternoon, early evening, we were pretty pretty awake, needless to say, right? But yeah, jet lag and that. So I don't remember much of it, but apparently there's some video out there. And at the time, they were doing a recording of Ride the Lightning, cover of it for, I think it was for Metal Hammer magazine. I'm not sure if that ever made the made the magazine or not, but we ended up playing it. And it was interesting, what I remember. That's, yeah, that's one memory of that. Things kind of happened. Basically, I had touring with Testament in between that, and then 2003, they released Enemies of Reality. I joined them on that tour, minus four shows, the first four that they did without me. But we picked up with them in September of 2003, and they kept insisting that I join their band. And I'm like, okay. What's on the table? So they told me what was up. They had a new record deal going, everything else like that. And hey, you know, we're gonna write a record together. And I was like, okay, cool, let's do this. So I left Testament to join Nevermore back in 2004, and things were quite busy from there. We wrote a record. We did some videos for their previous record, Enemies of Reality, and lots of touring in between that. And then we wrote This Godless Endeavor, got pushed back to record to early 2005. It was actually supposed to happen in 2004, but some things happened. Actually, Worrell had a near fatal illness that happened. And so luckily he got healed, and then we were able to continue and do that. We did a lot of touring behind this. We did a tour called Gigantour, which was Megadeth's, Dave Mustaine's kind of idea of having a large amphitheater size festival that was all outdoor for like 40 days across North America, and it was crazy. It was a lot of fun, and just a real blast. So that was really cool. That happened. I'm going to take you back to Dragonlord just really quickly, and show you a song from there. So there's this middle section. We did a lot of stuff that sounded like it was in four, but it's in 12/8, so it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. That's kind of the pulse, like a three pulse type of thing. And I'm going to take you through the song. It's called Judgment Failed. I think I'm going to end up playing it with. It's from the Rapture record, and it's really fast, so bear with me on this one. We'll be right back. one segues into another really fast zone, so.
Badass.
So, some really kind of cool stuff in there, just to show you that really quick. It's this thing. Eric had this riff, and the one thing that really stood out to me was the way that he accented it, and it really kind of always has stuck with me. The way that he accents is unique to him. The way that we all kind of accent something in terms of a riff or just a lead or what have you is always different. This one's kind of cool because it basically just hammers certain parts of the beat. It's kind of the different position of that. It's a different position scale, but it's basically a minor there, and then goes from E minor to D minor. I'm calling it by natural tuning, although we're on C sharp. Then we change up to like a Phrygian dominant sound again. So it's pretty prevalent sound, but it's not one that you think is gonna kind of come in there. And I think the one thing that always struck me was the way that the da 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 da. Not sure if I'm playing that loud enough for everybody to hear, but it's those little notes that kind of pop out. Yeah, that I always thought was really cool. So I wanted to share that. The other part is kind of my ode to Iron Maiden with the solo. Basically, I wanted to get like a. I was thinking, well, what would Adrian Smyth do in this kind of sound? And that was my kind of ode to Adrian Smyth. So I'll play a little bit of the ode. So it's a natural minor thing. So it's kind of thinking a little bit more classical kind of thing, and then. So I'm kind of thinking more harmonic minor there at that point of the change when it goes from the E chord to the D chord. Goes back to E again, so this is kind of the part where I was thinking Adrian Smyth. And then this bit, I'm not sure where this comes from, but. Kind of vibe or Adrian Smyth kind of playing country. That was my mode set, right? So just kind of getting like a bit wider kind of sound. These are sixth intervals when you're playing that, and I'm doing like a little hybrid thing there. And that was the only way I could think of to actually end that. So it was a bit more of a counter kind of thing to what was going on with the riff.
Really old captured airplane.
Yeah?
That's faster than sound. Check it out.
Nice. Bit more Paul Kantner then. Or Marty Balin. Right. Okay. Nice. Yeah, definitely. I'll take it. Absolutely. Yeah, so that's kind of my infusion, I guess, of that type of sound.
I got a question. Did Eric sing that?
Yes, he did.
Really?
Yeah, pretty much that. I don't remember who the lady was that sang with him, but yeah, definitely.
Did you guys wear corpse paint when you recorded it?
No, you were there. Do you remember?
Was I there?
Yeah.
Was that when you guys were in that room? The room.
Yeah, in the old test room.
I remember popping my head in there that day. It's
Yeah. No, definitely not. Would be the answer to that one. But Yeah, we did the whole corpse paint thing, everything else like that. I kind of got bored of that after a while. Totally. Whether or not they'll ever do another record again, because I left Dragonlord quite some time ago. I keep hearing about it, and I hope someday he'll actually get another one out. Because it's pretty cool stuff. It's a little bit different. It's not like the black metal that everybody thinks, oh my god, it's, you know, evil and all that kind of stuff.
So if you do Dragonlord again, are you going to dye your hair black again?
If you ask me back, because I left, so I don't know how that one would work, but no. I'm keeping it blunt all the way. Right. I guess I'm going to probably do one more song, because that's probably what I'm going to have time for to be able to do here. So if you guys bear with me, it's going to be on this other guitar, the 7-string. And it's going back to your days with Nevermore. It's a song called A Future Uncertain, and I wanted to kind of show you guys something with that, actually two things with that. Billy, do you mind if I grab an acoustic guitar? That's cool. Okay. So how many play acoustic guitar on a regular basis? Yeah? Cool. Everybody know dad-gad tuning? Yeah? It's a D-A-D, G-A-D, that kind of folksy tuning. This is probably not going to happen in the exact tuning, so I'm just going to go with dad-gad really quick. But I wrote this song called A Future Uncertain for that Nevermore record, and so many guitar players have asked me, how did you actually play the front of that song? I just taught this guy from Ireland the other day. He's all, I bought a 7-string acoustic thinking that you were playing that on a 7-string acoustic. I'm like, I don't even think they had 7-string acoustics back when we did that song. But he was a little bummed, but he got over it. So I showed him the riff and how I played it. It's basically dad-gad tuning, but it's tuned to B flat. So like I said, it's not going to handle this guitar. This is dad-gad, D-A-D-G-A-D. Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty cool. So it's one of those that works really well for open tunings, instant chords, that kind of thing. But when I had this song, it was just really kind of this weird beginning, and Warl really liked it, and he just wanted to do something kind of, as he said, hippie over it. And anyone that knows Warl kind of knows that he was definitely a hippie through and through. So I'm going to play it in a different tuning, then I'll play the front of the song, and then I'm going to play with it, so you can see the rest of what we're doing. But it starts with this. Let's see if I can do this here. I just gotta remember one thing. Okay, as long as I can remember this. So the front part was basically this. Starts with that, right? That's the front of that. The chords are kind of a weird thing. It's basically a sort of a basically a three and a four, so basically a sus happening in there. And then we get to a flat six at the end of that. So it's more based on, tuning. Another favorite mode of mine, it's basically, most people call this harmonic major. It's one of the melodic minor modes. I like looking at it as basically a mixolydian, but with a flat six. And it gives you this really weird kind of twist with that. Going to that flat six from the seven. I really like it a lot. So this is what happened with that. And I'm afraid I'm going to have to play this with the album. Because I don't know where the masters are. but they're not with me. So I'll play the front of this one.
We'll be right back.
Masterclass for today. Thank you all very much for being here. I appreciate it so much. Be sure.